can be seated. Hallelujah. So many people didn't come to me tonight because they got the spirit of offense. You know where they got the spirit of offense from? They got fenced in with that spirit of offense too, because they didn't have it their way. It didn't work out like they wanted to. They've got other priorities. They're rising up. They're sorting things out for themselves. They're deciding how they're going to live their life, what they're going to do with their life. But all, you know what? All of a sudden, your life comes to an end. Now you're going, what are you doing now? What are you doing now? You think you can live part-time for God and be right with God? I'm going to tell you right now, you're not going to disrespect Him like that. It's about time people learn that they're not going to disrespect God and find somehow that they are holy and acceptable unto Him. You're going to put God first. People put their work first. They put their house first. They put their mortgage first. They put all this other stuff first. It's going to be a sad day for you. I'm going to tell you, if there's anything people need, it's the fear of the Lord. If there's anything that describes doing, then those who know their God will do great exploits. That's really in the context, really, of the tribulation and dealing with the Antichrist. But there is an application now. Even though we can take that and remove it out of Daniel, as he's making concluding remarks about the end of the things of the world and the governments of men, there's an application now in dealing with the Antichrist spirit. We can look in Revelation chapter 12 and see that when Satan's given power to overcome the saints, that the saints then are able to stand in a place of not being subdued because of the word of their testimony, because of the blood of the Lamb, the word of their testimony, because they love not their life even unto death. And although that is an application to an end time situation during the tribulation of the saints of God that primarily come out of Israel, because it's that moment in time that their eyes, listen, I tell you, I know what I'm talking about. It's at that moment in time that the blindness is taken off of them. Somebody said, well, how about the church going through the tribulation? There's no church going through the tribulation. Not the glorious church. Jesus Christ is going to come when there's no more harvest. People want it to be now. The time's not now. Somebody told me a couple years ago, all through these past different times, and it's crazy to me why people just can't get over. Past 30 years, people tell me, well, such and such is going to happen. I said, no, it's not going to happen that way. Well, how do you know? Because I read the book. I mean, I didn't just read the book. I've given myself to studying it, giving myself continually the study of the Word. And then somebody tells me, next year, and the next 10 years. And people tell me last year, this and that, and the other thing's going to happen. I said, no, it's not. They look at me. How do you know? Because I know. I know what the end point looks like. And all I have to do is interpolate where I'm at right now. I know there's several events that's got to take place. And it's about time, but the reality of it is your end of your world's about to come. You're about to leave this world and go into the next. Yours is coming very soon. Very soon. Maybe 60, 70 years. Some of you, 30, 40 years. Some of you maybe even that are in here, maybe 20 years. Some of you next year. Some of you maybe 2 months from now. Some of you maybe next week. Then you're going to stand before the living God, and this tells you exactly what you're going to experience. There's no uncertainties. People give themselves, there's many people in here with doctorate's degrees. People give themselves earnestly to the study of those things which men have to say. And then just sit around with critical remarks, censoring the things that God has to say. But I tell you, better get yourself some wisdom. Quit diddle-dallying around. You better find out what God has to say. There's nothing more important than what Father has to say. And we're pleading with you tonight. God the Holy Ghost is a pleader. God the Holy Ghost is called parakalitos in the Greek language. It's a very difficult word to understand etymologically, linguistically. It's a very difficult word. A word, parakleion, is one of the words that form parakletos. Just say it a little bit more like Greek, okay? Like the Greek people say it, like them folks from Greece. And literally, Parakaleos, parakaleon, rather, means to plead. One of the primary ways you define that is to plead. And parakaleon is really how we mostly understand the parakaletos, which most people call parakaletos, right? That's how most people say it. It's just the way Americans say parakaletos. Parakletos, or however they say it. But anyway, the name of the Holy Ghost, he's pleading with us. He's pleading with us. He's alongside of us, para, alongside of us, kalitos. And we translate that helper, comforter, a few other things. We can translate it mentor. But really, more than anything else, he's pleading with us. He's pleading with us. Because there's a day of judgment coming. And God has opened up the door and is crying out, saying, flee from the wrath that is to come. Because Father's going to pour out his wrath upon sin and iniquity. He's going to do it. Yes, the sin that you like, he's going to pour out his wrath and iniquity on it. And if it's on you, you're going to be the subject of his wrath. Period. And it's happening right now. Literally, hundreds of thousands of people are falling into eternity right now. They're coming into judgment. Somebody said, oh, judgment's deferred. Well, not really. Not really. Judgment's happening right today, right alongside of mercy. There's great mercy right now. There's mercy for everybody. You can come on in. No matter who you are, no matter what you've done, no matter what your background is, there's mercy for you to be cleansed, to be washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, to receive the very life of God, the life of Jesus, to now live an entirely different existence. I said existence. Not just go on and behave as a mere human being living in a world of demonic empowerment and influence. Different existence. Clean escape. Come out from among them. Be separate, says the Lord. I receive you kind of existence. But there's judgment right now too, because people are literally coming to the end of their life. They're breathing out their last breath right now all over the world. Tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people falling off into eternity right now, into an eternity without God. Somebody says, well, I don't understand how a loving God would do that. It's because you don't understand. You have a very limited ability to even comprehend the things of God, and especially within a natural mind. The Word of God will give you insight and cause you to realize that there's a whole lot different things going on than what you've encountered. There's a whole lot more going on than what you've encountered. And God hates sin so much. Sin is so horrific to him, which you cannot comprehend with an unregenerated mind. Thus you are under the empowerment and deception of humanism. You cannot imagine a God of judgment that would destroy people eternally in a place called hell, the lake of fire. It's real. Jesus spent a lot of time talking about it. It's about time people wake up and understand that the fear of the Lord is very important to God. Amen. The Hebrew word yara or yare literally means to be in awe, to be struck with awe, to be captivated, to be almost paralyzed with who he is. I mean, you talk about looking unto the author and finisher of our faith, looking unto Jesus. Talk about being in awe and sinning not. Get yourself some fear of the Lord. I'll tell you right now, it'll really deal with how you capitulate and commit the acts of treason against Almighty by participating with sin. You're going to get over your sin, or you're going to end up in eternity in a place called the lake of fire with your sin. Now, how good is that pleasure for you? Because I'm going to tell you right now, the consequence of your temporal pleasure is an eternity of torment. Now, that's what God says. Now, you may not say that, and people that you know may not say that, but that's what God says. And in his love for us, he came and gave to us the opportunity to step in a life so abundant that we won't even want the eating out of the garbage can anymore. Amen. We don't want to go dip our cup in the sewer runoff anymore to get a drink. Amen. We're sitting up at the table of the majesty. We're sitting up at the table of the king. We're sitting up in the glory realm of heaven. We should be shining bright with his presence and with his goodness and with his demeanor and with his nature and with his goodness so much that all the world look and see, wow, that's so different. It's like a light shining in a dark place. But sin will compromise you. Sin will make you ugly. U-G-L-Y. Deeply so. Ugly. Truly will. God will beautify you.
Amen.
It says He beautifies the meek with salvation.
Amen.
He pours forth, His oil of joy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Kandori kashi apahan. I want you to open your Bibles quickly with me to Proverbs in chapter 2. And you know, there is not a person that we don't love. We love people. We love the people of God, and we love the people of this world. God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son. But we're not going to sit around and play some patty cake games with you, walk on eggshells, act like you're right with God when you're not. Huh? I'm not going to let you have an incurable disease when I can cure it. Just act like you don't notice. Just act like you don't notice that there's a demon hanging on top of their head. I'm going to jerk the thing off. God told me to go cast out devils.
Yes, amen.
Cast it out with the word.
Yes.
God, here's how. You know how Jesus told me to minister? You know how Jesus ministered? He said, go on the world and preach the gospel. Everybody that believes, repents and believes, they'll be saved. Those that do not believe, you tell them. You let them know. They're damned. You damned. Damned to an eternity without God. People don't want to do that in a humanistic world. They don't want to believe that. That's why people go marching out of this place in droves. But they've heard the gospel. And God's word's not going to return void. Ain't nobody ever got around me and been haunted for the rest of their life. They go to therapy, try to get rid of my voice out of their head. There's no medication. There's no psychiatrist, no psychologist that can help you after you've been around me. It's too late. The only one can help you is the Holy Ghost. And He will fill you up with such good stuff. Hallelujah. You never want to go back to darkness. You never want to go back to sin. You won't want to go back to the mud pits of Goshen, to be a slave, to be tormented and whipped by the whip of a tyrant and taskmaster called sin. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You hear where the light's shining now. You hear where the light's shining now. Everything's exposed. Everything's exposed. And we're going to point things out that we see as God lets us. There's some things we won't point out because we're not going to embarrass you on the level that would cause you to become sick of heart over it all. We're gonna get after you. We're gonna let you know that you're being confronted. God, the Holy Ghost, is confronting you about your soul, and it is a perilous situation. It is a dramatic situation. It is more dramatic. It is more intense than if I stood and watched you in a house and it was burning down, and you got 2 seconds to get out. That's how I'm gonna treat you. I'm gonna deal with you with that kind of nerves. I'm not gonna hey, good fella. You're about to burn. Excuse me. Sir? Ma'am? Do you realize you're about to be toast? Yeah, the fire's all around you? I'm plead with you. I'm beseech you. I'm beg you. I'm cry out to you. I'm going to lift up my voice. Hallelujah. If you're here tonight and you're not on fire, but you got a little bit of smoke, we're not going to put you out. We're going to come around you and we're going to encourage that smoke. Hallelujah. Smoking flesh will he not quench. Yeah, all you got to do is just have a little bit of smoke. Smoke is indication that there was one time a fire. Or that you're nearly to have a fire. One of the two. Hallelujah. We're going to encourage that. We're going to help you. But God separates. He's always separating. He separates sin from righteousness, good from evil, light from darkness, death from life. He separates. Oh, don't separate me. You're separating. You're being separated. Chaff from wheat. Lambs from goats. God don't let the goats run with the lambs. Because if the goats run with the lambs will never eat, they'll never rest, because the goats are just incorrigible. They don't stop. Huh? You listening? Constantly creating a fuss. God separates. Aren't you happy?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come search me, O God. Come try me, Lord. Know my thoughts. Search me, O God. Know my heart. See if there be any wicked way in me. Lead me in the way everlasting. And His goodness, He's come to lead men into repentance. Woo! He's come to deliver us from everything that is evil. Woo! He's come to teach us all the ways of life. But we got to be able to respond a little bit. I would just rather see somebody basically doing somersaults on the floor just in their enthusiasm and zeal instead of standing there like, I mean, maybe, you know, maybe here tonight and you don't know a word of English. So you know anything we've said? Huh? Then we can understand why you're sitting there going. But otherwise, there's no reason for it. You're just being sorted out. Why? So you can repent. I know you go in many churches, you can live like the devil, go in many churches and look just like everybody else. There'd be no distinction. There's no distinction between the world and a lot of Christians, supposed Christians. Christian by name, Christian by religion. Not Christian by experience, not one who's like Christ. Christian means one like Christ. Who was first called Christians? Holy Ghost-filled apostles. People who these signs shall follow them, men and women of God. People on fire with the glory of heaven. Hallelujah. You know how many times, you know how many times God's people are called Christians in the Bible? Huh? Twice. Huh? That's all right. There's various different versions. That's all right. I can see where there would be a third one, based upon certain translations from various different extant manuscripts. So I understand that. That's not, you're close. 3 to 2, 2 to 3, you're in. But that's it. You know what we're called in the Bible?
Saints.
Saints.
Amen.
Holy ones. Talk to you about being saints tonight. Santos. Hallelujah. All the Bible is written to saints. Holy people. God made us holy through the new covenant. Made us holy through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. It's what He invites us to come to be. God creates a new race. He doesn't leave people in their sin. And now you're right with God. You're still in your sin, but now you're right with God because you believe in a religious figure? That's nonsense. That is nothing other than the ideologies and the philosophies and the traditions of men that have spoiled people after the rudiments of the world. Is not the gospel, that is not the Bible. God's word is very clear on these things. Salvation is to be washed with the water of regeneration and to be renewed with the Holy Ghost. Salvation is where you and I are born again, born of the Holy Ghost. Jesus said, he says to Nicodemus, that which is born of the flesh cannot come in. It doesn't matter that you memorize the whole Bible. It doesn't matter that you have a hunger towards God. It does not matter, Nicodemus, that you're the ruler of the Jews. You can't come in. You're outside. God is a holy God. Holiness is defined by the very fact that He is separated from everything that men do. He's separated from the world. People say, we're all the children of God. That's nonsense. You're the child of the devil. You're children of the demonic realm until you're born of God. And there's only one way to be born of God, is by the Spirit. And the only way you can be born of God by the Spirit is call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. That's just the final word. Jesus gave the final word. He said, they that believe shall be saved. Saved. Paul defined it in Titus chapter 3, verse 5. Saved by the washing of the water of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. The definition of what saved is. Salvation is to be delivered. Delivered from a realm of the demonic. Delivered from the realm of the world. Delivered from the realm of the curse of sin. Brought into the kingdom of God. When you do respond to Him, in His mercy and His grace, He gives you His very life. And so it's not trying to guess. I wonder if I'm saved. You're not. If you're wondering, you're not. If you're not sure, you're not. If you're not sure that you're saved, you're not saved. Period. Because when you get saved, when the power of God comes upon you and creates a new man, brings forth a new creation, you literally receive the life of God. The life of Christ Jesus. The life of the Holy Ghost. You become the temple of the Holy Ghost. I mean, God moves the holies of holies inside you. Hallelujah. Because Father doesn't dwell any place outside the holies of holies. Men may come and minister unto Him in the holy place, but He's only dwelling in the holies of holies. Hallelujah. God's a holy God. That means He's completely separated from everything that is in the world. And that's what He said when he called Moses up. He allowed Moses to come and behold Him. And He said, you tell everybody else, they stay away. And if they even get near the boundary of this place where I'm at right now, you kill them. Do not let them live for their disobedience. And because I'm not going to have my realm polluted with unholy men. And now through the blood of Jesus Christ, God looks and extends to us His blessings and His mercy. That salvation that is in Christ Jesus is so glorious and so complete that He says, come on in. He says, He doesn't say, draw not nigh. Now He says, peace to you that are far away, come on in. Peace to you that are near, come on in. I remove the center wall partition between those who belong to me, the people, the Jews, and on the Gentiles. I make no distinction between you. I say, and invite everybody to come in, but through the door. Jesus, not through a window, not through the roof, not tunnel under, through the door. I invite you to come through the door. There is no name given unto men whereby they must be saved, but by the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus carries all power and all authority in it. That name will cause you to receive a miracle that transforms your life, that takes away and crucifies that which is old, buries it, puts it to death, and a new man risen up, a new life brought forth, the reproduction of Christ Jesus' life in you and me, that we may say, Christ is in me. Amen. We're living at the forefront of the time that men will not endure sound doctrines. At the forefront. Although the Antichrist spirit has been working for 1971 years, since the death of the Lord Jesus and resurrection and ascension, exaltation, and pouring out of the Holy Ghost at the birth of the church. Amen. Amen. Still, we're on the front end of just the very beginning of the apostasy of the church. People look at it now and they go, no, we're in it. No, we're not. It's going to get a whole lot worse. And right now we have a window of a time to run to the nations of the earth. But we can't have a bunch of deadheads running around. You can't just reap. Listen, you got to understand something. There is a force of hell against the church. And you are no match for the deception and the force of hell that is against the church. You're no match for it. Unless you're baptized in the Holy Ghost, standing in this glory realm that we're allowed to stay in, where we dwell in Christ Jesus. Otherwise, you're going to come under the influence of that deceptive power, and you're going to act just like the rest of these people that call themselves Christians, and they're no more born again than my puppy dog. I don't have one. I used to have one. And that's just how unborn again they are. Somebody said, you don't have the right to say it. Oh, yeah, I do. The Word of God is very specific on what it means to be born again and very clear and detailed on the fruits and the evidence of the new birth. Oh, yeah. Said, you don't know people's hearts. I'm going to tell you right now, your mouth is revealing it. and so are your deeds, and so are your actions. God says you don't get sweet water from a bitter fountain. You don't get evil fruit from a good tree. You make the tree good and the fruit good, and you make the tree evil and its fruit evil. Somebody says, I'm not so bad. Oh, yeah, you are. You look just like the devil till you're born again. Oh, yeah, you are. You can't come into the kingdom of God. You live in a relativism. You live in a relative situation. You compare yourself with everybody else, and you define what is good based upon your culture. And that does not define reality. God's word defines reality about what good is. God's word defines reality about what is pleasing and holy and acceptable unto him. And there's no way for man to ever in any way accomplish that without the new birth and without the power of the Holy Ghost. Listen to me. It's conceited legalism that believes that you can serve God and be pleasing to God without the Holy Spirit. Having begun in the Spirit, you only made perfect by the Holy Ghost. You better learn how to walk in the Spirit. As many as are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. And be certain of this. If you're not moving with the Holy Ghost and being led by him, you're not the son of God. Sons of God. Children of God. It's coming under the mandate of the Holy Ghost, who comes to protect us and keep us from all the onslaught of the demonic forces of the demonic realm. Huh? Hey, Jewish people are very good people. I know the Haredim, which are the ultra-Orthodox Jews, who, I mean, I'm telling you, from the outward appearance, I mean, they look better than most Christians. They're on their way to hell, an eternity without God. Humanism cries out against that and says it cannot be. The Bible's very clear on it. Jesus said, I'm it. I'm the truth, the life, the way. No man comes to the Father but by me. No man can know the Father. Let the Son reveal him. And I could stand here all night and quote such scriptures. I'm just going to quote the Bible to you. I'm not going to quote philosophy to you. Amen. I know many Mormons. I mean, my goodness, my children basically had to hang out with the Mormons because most of the Christians compromise and are involved in pornography and alcohol. But the Mormons live clean lives. They don't have that mess going on in their house. So they hung out with Mormons. But the Mormons are on their way to an eternity without God because they deny the Son for who he is. Does that mean we're anti-Mormon or anti-Jew? By no means. Our passion is to see their lives transformed and changed by the power of God. I'm not arguing with anybody. I'm bringing the power of the Holy Ghost to them. I'm going to deal with them about the reality of who Jesus is. Want Jesus? The Mormons are very close to the kingdom of God. All they got to do is repent of their heresy and embrace Jesus Christ as the Almighty God. Hallelujah. Somebody said, can't you make heaven? You just think that Jesus is an angel? Well, listen, I'm going to tell you right now, I don't believe the Holy Ghost is going to come on you and he's going to change you and give you the miracle of salvation without accepting who Jesus Christ is, the eternal word. I just don't believe it. I don't believe you can believe a lie. And it's a subtle lie. When you think about it, you break out Mormonism for what most Mormons believe. And that goes, most Mormons never even read the Book of Mormons. They just read basically the Bible. Believe me. And they're very bright. They're not like a bunch of dumb people, you know. And the very subtlety, as it were, that separates them from eternal life. Well, how about all the false doctrine in the Pentecostal movement? How about all the false doctrine in the Protestant movement? How about all the things we bought into and believes not in the Bible? It's just tradition, it's philosophy, it's things that have been handed down from one generation to another, and men have been the disciples of man rather than disciples of the Holy Ghost who's come to lead us and guide us into all truth. It's like pulling teeth from a chicken to get God's people to read the Bible. It is. I'm telling you right now, if you read three chapters a day, you know how long it takes to read three chapters a day? I try to read as slow as I possibly could, got it done in less than 10 minutes. I tried, I said, okay, let me just see if I might maybe I could just really slow this down. Behold the noise of, 10 minutes, less than 10 minutes. And you'll read the whole Bible, three chapters a day. You'll read the whole Bible in a year. But unless you start reading three chapters every day and get disciplined about it, you won't read the Bible one time in the next 10 years. When you could read it 10 times in the next 10 years. I'm not going to be that slow. I love the Word. His Word's spirit and life. His Word's a great comfort to me. I get excited by the Word. We're going to do the School of the Spirit on Friday. And I'm going to talk to you, I'm going to talk on the school, in the School of the Spirit, about how the manifest presence of God accompanies the spoken word. And how that you can begin to walk around in your house or in your yard or driving in your car, and you can begin to declare the word. Amen. And you begin to, as you begin to speak out the word, not what you know about the word, but the word, literally the word. I mean, the people that commute, you are blessed. I memorized whole books of the Bible when I was commuting to work here in San Diego before the Lord wouldn't allow me to be bivocational anymore in that way. It's easy. Got the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, I don't got a good memory. No worries. Forget the good memory. That's overrated. You got the Holy Ghost. He'll bring into your remembrance. Someday he'll give you a good memory. Praise God. Hallelujah. Dear people, and what you just start off with is you just take a highlighter and you go through and you just mark everything in your Bible on the Holy Ghost. Okay? And then what's better to do with that than just leaving in the highlight? Because most of you have computers, and God gave you computers to be able to do these kinds of things with the computer, not the other stuff you've been doing with it. And now you can just go in there and you can just take and put on one document, every scripture on the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Then you just stand around and you just speak out everything that God says about the Holy Ghost. Ooh, hallelujah. And just read it down the page. And before long, I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to just start bubbling up out of the inside of you. Now you're going to speak after the manner of the word. Now you're going to be trained like Samuel was trained by the Holy Ghost as he ministered to the light of the temple, the revelation of God. And he came into a place as a priest of the Lord that was so given over to the things of the Father that not one of his words fell to the ground. Everything he said, God fulfilled. Amen. And Father's got that purpose for us. He told us to come and abide in him, come dwell in Jesus. Come on, people, come dwell in me. Hallelujah. Got many rooms in Father's house. Come dwell in me. Come on now. Come on in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And he says, what was that? And he said this. He said that if we dwell in him and his words dwell in us, then we'll ask whatever we will. That's the same thing. It's not letting any of our words fall to the ground. He said, I am the vine, you the branch dwell in the vine, then the branch will bring forth fruit. Mm-hmm. And he said, and then of course you get on down, and of course I just basically gave a quick overview of John chapter 51 through 1 through 6. Of course I left out one of the most important verses of scripture there, verse 5, you can do nothing without me. And people are hard-headed. Even after you've been born again, people are hard-headed. And they don't get that. Can do nothing without me. It's one of the pillars of moving in the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hallelujah. It's an offense to God for us to go and try now to perfect anything about ourselves. It's an offense to God. In fact, Paul said, he said to the church at Galatia, small little thing, Galatians chapter 5, you've fallen from grace. Who has bewitched you? How did you get bewitched? How did you come under the enticing power of demonic spirits to go and start believing another form of the gospel? And he just simply said, anybody that trusts in anything besides Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone for salvation has made the faith of Jesus Christ of no effect. That's pretty radical, isn't it? How much stuff have you added? It's an offense to God to try to walk out something in relationship with him without the Holy Ghost. God respects no man's person. God receives praise from no man. Huh?
That's right.
You listen to me. He's given us the Holy Ghost to be able to come and worship him and praise him. He's not interested in the sound of our voice. He's not interested in it. He's interested in the sound of the Spirit of the living God dwelling on the inside of us, and us now being willing to be completely given over to him to be in every way conformed to the image of the Son. And I just slapped humanism so hard, I doubt it will regain consciousness in the next several hours. Because people's doctrines are so filtered through humanism, they can't even begin to comprehend some of these things. Oh, we're supposed to be all happy about ourselves and high on ourselves. You crucified. The old man stinks. Buried, praise God. Hallelujah. Raised up together. And we need to understand, dear people, you don't get a resurrection until you get yourself a crucifixion. You don't get to get raised from the dead till you die. And a new creation came forth. It belongs to a new race. I just like to go ahead and just lay it down radical. Let everybody just let it fall out where it may. Get all upset if you want. You'll understand one day. I don't belong to merely a human race. I've been brought into the family of God. Christ Jesus, my brother, Almighty God is my father. Holy Ghost is like my mother almost, you know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. I'm an heir of God, co-inheritor with Jesus. Give me a break. I belong to a whole new realm. I don't fit in. The world is crucified to me and I'm crucified to it. The world hates me and I hate it. Well, certainly within the respect of hating my life that was in the world. Huh? Yes, God so loved the world. But it's not a relationship love, and that's what we're talking about. I don't have a relationship with the world. God does not have a relationship with the world. Friendship with the world, and understand it very clearly, friendship with the world is an act of hostility, an act of treason against God. That's what James said, and it's true. Jesus said, the world hates me. When we read God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believes should not perish but should have everlasting life. God's not talking about a love relationship. Do you understand me? Jesus said, he said, if you obey me, if you keep my words, then my Father will love you. Hello. John chapter 14. Then my Father will love you and we will come make our abode. That's relationship love. A relationship love that can only exist when you and I are transformed, changed. We don't look like the devil no more. Praise God. I hated looking like the devil and acting like the devil. Come on, man. Come on, people. Come on now. You're going to have to get yourself a new identity. You're going to have to belong to a new company. You're going to have to come all the way over here and stand on the other side of the flood with the Father, with the Lord Jesus. We want to pat everybody on the back and say, oh, you're going to be all right. When in reality, we should have rebuked them and reproved them because they're going to spend an eternity without God. But well, no, we're stewed, cooked in humanism. And under the influence of the demonic power, where we're more interested in people liking us and us liking on an earthly human level, and we never stepped into our heavenly relationship. God places in the, we're citizens of heaven. Our conversation is supposed to be in heaven. We're seated in heaven. Our whole life is about being an ambassador and being a witness of the heavenly realm that is very distinctively different from a worldly realm, calling people out of that which the wrath of God abides on. Hello? It's not Mr. and Mrs. Nice Guy. It says who shine with the radiant love of the power and the glory of God, who's calling all men to repentance. You don't call people to repentance by saying, oh, you're going to do okay. We just believe it in you. Because they already believe it in themselves, and you just confirm their state of iniquity. You listen to me. And change. In Jesus' name. I command you to change. I told you to turn to Proverbs chapter 2, didn't I? I'm still trying to find it. I'm like over here in the New Testament. Hallelujah. Ha ha ha. That's why a computer is good for someone drunk in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You just kind of type it in. And then you can't find the buttons to type. And then you're just kind of shut down. Just got a quote. Amen. Quoting's easy in the Holy Ghost. My son, if you will receive my words and hide my commandments with thee. That's a very protective posture, a very hungry and loving disposition to say, I exalt God's orders and His commands and what He wants above everything else, and I'm going to hide it with me. It's my treasure. I'm not going to let it go. It's so important to me. I want it more than anything. He says then, so that you will, and if you will incline your ear unto wisdom and understand, wisdom proceeds out of His mouth. Understanding comes from Him and Him alone. There is a knowledge and an understanding and a wisdom that belongs to the realms of God, and there is a knowledge and a wisdom and understanding that belongs to the world of men. It was created by the prince of the power of the air, the god of this world. He's a brilliant devil who's the master of deception, who's created the sociology that you love so much. It's a good thing you weren't born in Irian Jaya, hunting heads and eating elbows. I'll just tell you right now, there's still cannibals alive today. There is. I met a preacher in the outback of Australia who they were throwing spears at airplanes going over in the mid-60s. And there was some kind of crazy bird. And they were cannibals. They still ate human flesh. Nothing wrong with that when you come from that culture. And your culture is just as evil. You go into certain places in Irian Jaya and they lust after you, but not like they lust after you here in the West. They want to make you stew. And your head will look like, once it's shrunk down, it'll look a nice little ornament on their little shelf. They're thinking about how they new decoration and the taste buds are going. Saliva starts coming out the sides of the mouth. Jesus is helping. And that is just as bad as what you're in right now. And what you're in is probably a little bit worse than what they're in. Huh? Both of them are just bad. I just want to make it bad because it's bad. Relativism going to get you nowhere. Situational ethics. What you believe based upon all the people that around you told you what was right and what was wrong. The Word of God is very different on its definition of what's right and what's wrong. What God says about what's right, not a human being on the planet without the Holy Ghost, without being born again and being filled with the Holy Ghost, can in any way begin to comprehend it, understand it, or much less begin to have such behavior. But God, according to His divine power, that's a whole lot of power that created everything. God, by His divine power, gave us everything that pertains to life and godliness so that we could live out the life of glory and virtue that He's called us to. That's true. Every good and perfect gift came down from Him. Hallelujah. And He says He wants us to grab a hold of it. He wants us to get after wisdom and knowledge and understanding. He wants us to pursue these things. And you leave it on the shelf. You leave it on the shelf and just spot check the Word every once in a while. There's a problem there. You'll never grow there. You'll never come into spirit knowledge that can begin to move and function out of the realms of the Holy Ghost. It'll be all subjective. It'll be more fashioned after men's likeness than after the likeness of God. If what you say and speak doesn't come from the wellspring and the riches and the treasure of His Word. Because all God the Holy Ghost really is going to be doing is the Word. He's the Spirit of truth. God's Word is truth. Jesus said, my Word is truth. He said, I am the truth. All the Holy Ghost is going to be doing is talking about the living Word, which is the full expression of the written Word. For Jesus said, lo, I've come in the volume of the book. It's written of me. Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. If you want to get it, here it is. How hungry are you? How hungry are you? 3 chapters a day, and you can read the Bible in a year. And it takes less than for the average reader, 5 minutes is all it would take. And you don't have time? You deceived, man. You're messing around. You've evaluated your life wrong and exalted things in your life above God. Now stop it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Did you notice I'm not walking on eggshells? I'm not concerned about your attitude, or I have no fear of man. This just doesn't exist. It does not matter to me what you think about me. What matters to me is for you to be confronted with the truth. What matters to me is for you to deal with reality. Before the living God, I'm standing here to you, before you tonight, and I've given myself more to the study of the Word of God than my friends who are physicians, neuroscientists, list goes on, have given themselves to their discipline. And I know more about my discipline than the neuroscientist knows about his. By and large, people thirst, as it were, for knowledge. If they can somehow benefit themselves, they're going to go to the class or the seminar or to the school. And they're going to labor long hours so that they can obtain that knowledge, because it takes that to get the knowledge. But when it comes to the Word of God, we're just constantly cutting Him short, acting like we're doing Him a service. Big favor that we showed up. Have been doing God a big favor to show up to be a false witness? To be a false witness of who He is and what life He's given? I'm bust humanism off of you. I'm going to break the chains off of you so you can start hearing God. Yes. Amen. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. Well, hey, turn the heat up so the wax will melt out. Yes. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. If you incline your ear into wisdom and you apply your heart to understanding. Yea, if you cry out after knowledge and you lift up your voice for understanding. And I'm going to tell you, people, God is talking about His Word here. He's talking about the B-I-B-L-E that many people can't seem to find enough time to include in their life, which is spirit and life. The flesh profits nothing. It's the spirit that quickens. My word is spirit and life. John 6:63, that's what Jesus said. There's something wrong with your spirit. Something wrong with you. When personal relationship isn't enough to motivate you to hunger after the Word, you got to have some kind of position in something or church or whatever to get you motivated to go study the Bible. I don't want that kind of relationship. Thank you. I'm not interested. For me, that's a definition of religion. That's religious. Huh? It's a carrot for me. I'm interested in the praises of men, pats on the back. Give me a break. There's something far better. Come on, get over here. There's a relationship to have with the living God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I don't need to preach. I preach by mandate. I go where I go and I say what I say by mandate. I don't need to preach. I have a beautiful relationship with God. I'm filled up to the full. I don't need to be anything. I've been given everything that I need. I'm complete in Him. I don't have any missing pieces. I can enjoy His presence all alone. Hallelujah. But in that love relationship with Him, He told me, go open my mouth and speak all these things that He puts in it. Hallelujah. Which is His Word. He's not going to have me speaking anything He didn't say in His Word. Anybody who has anything to say, they don't speak after this Word, it's because there's no light in them. If there's no light in a person, what is there?
Darkness.
Darkness. What does that mean? They're not right with God. And if all of a sudden you begin to utilize that as a test and evaluation for who you're going to listen to, I just knocked a bunch of preachers off the, you know, off the list. Because they're speaking in espousing all kinds of things continually. They're not speaking the Word. God told us to speak the Word only. God the Holy Ghost is speaking the Word only. Jesus spoke the Word only. He defeated the biggest challenge that hell could raise against man. He defeated all hell with Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. Man should not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. That's how powerful the Old Testament is. By the new covenant originator. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I've not found anything in the New Testament that contradicts anything in the Old Testament. I just found that the fulfillment of it has come into place. Now we get to live it out by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And the Holy Ghost is teaching us truth.
Yes.
And the truth is the Word.
Yes.
You can memorize the whole Bible and it mean nothing to you until the Holy Ghost is allowed to come and open up your understanding so that you know the Word. So He give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation. Huh? On the road to Emmaus, Jesus opened up their understanding. They may understand. They may know what the prophet said.
Amen.
Huh? Spirit of the Lord comes. Causes us to see what eyes not see, hear what ears not heard, understand what's never entered the heart of man. It's kind of to reveal these things to us. Ooh, Spirit of truth, come lead us and guide us. Come help us. Come encourage us. Come shape us. Come build us up. Come strengthen us. But he doesn't do it. He does not do it apart from the Word. Doesn't do it apart from Christ Jesus, the living Word. Doesn't do it apart from the written Word that describes to us everything about Christ Jesus. Otherwise, you're just living a subjective life towards God, and you just building it up based upon what you believe and what you think. And I find that every day what I believe and what I think is refined and corrected by the Word of God. Hallelujah. You know how many times I've read the Bible? And read it in the original language? Listen to me. I just started reading Genesis chapter 1 the other day because it just started back, the beginning. So I just got to start back in the beginning. Like you're worn out. I mean, this is life. Hello, spirit and life. What do you mean? I get to start back at the beginning. I'm not worn out. I'm refreshed. I'm more excited about this. I'm just, wow. I mean, the Lord's speaking to me. Just, I've read so many times. It's like the psalmist said, open up my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your word. It's so beautiful. I always have a Holy Ghost breakdown reading the word. I always get translated, called away, caught up. People, you're missing out. If you're not filled with the Word of God, you're filled with the Word of men. And I'm going to tell you right now, 99% God's Word and 1% man's Word is a compromise. It's about time you just start living by the Word. Give yourself to the Word. Crying, lifting up your voice, crying after knowledge. Because ultimately here, God's going to train you in the realms of spirit knowledge. Joshua got to live around Moses. And Moses was anointed of the Holy Ghost in such a way that none of those movies you've watched on television, they're all a bunch of lies. Lies. Contaminating the truth with a crazy imagination. Moses, when he stepped in to this walk with God, they had to veil his face because there was a lethal light glowing off of him. He glowed with the glory of God. He was an oracle, living testimony, speaking out God's word. That's what Joshua got to live around. And of course, you know, he saw the glory at the tabernacle. Scripture says he never departed from the door of the tabernacle. Come on now, you listening to me?
Yes.
This is where you get spirit knowledge to speak to the moon, sun, say, stand still. One time Moses did deviate. He says, must I fetch water from the rock for you rebels? The Lord said, okay, because you did that, you're not coming in. You're dying now. You're dying. You're going to die now. You're not going in. Because God dealt with things on an immediate basis, right? There was no provision for him, as it were, to be able to have that cleansed and washed away and remembered no more as there is for us today. God has given us so much more and we do so much less with it. And it's about time we change the tide on this thing here. Like the streams from the south. Hallelujah. There's another wind blowing, a new wind blowing. Halabakataya Rasta. New wind of revival. It's true. Moses lived in a continuous glory glow. He lived in the revelation of who God is, who God was. He lived in a continuous revelation of Christ Jesus, the Word, the eternal Word. And that's what, that was Holy Ghost. He lived in a Holy Ghost meeting. Cloud by day, fire by night, glory of God on the tabernacle, and he was the administrator over it. That's heaven right there. I don't care if he's in the wilderness. That's like heaven. That's what you want. People say, what's heaven going to be like? What's the millennial reign going to be like? It's like that, but in a paradise, not in a wilderness. In a paradise and not in a wilderness. In a paradise where there is no sin, where there is no rebellion, where there is no iniquity, where there is no stubbornness, because all that's been purified. It's all been purified out. The stubbornness and the rebellion. Now, there is, during the millennium, now I just went to the eternal perfect earth and saying that, after the millennial reign of Christ. During the millennial, there's still going to be people, millennial reign of Christ, there's still going to be rebels. People who are still stubborn, people who are still arguing, still people want to do it their own way. And God's going to deal with them for 1,000 years, the end of 1,000 years. He's going to loose Satan for a little season. And the scripture says that they will literally flock unto Satan from every part of the earth, because only in his presence can they be the rebels they want to be and commit the acts of iniquity that they wanted to commit and try to rise up and break off the chains of God's anointing, the bonds of God's anointing. Huh? Baby, you better get yourself some holy fear. I don't see anybody shaking yet. Somebody said, what are you preaching for? I'm waiting for people to start shaking in the presence of God, because I believe that's what Father wants to do. And you're going to have to quit hardening your heart and sheltering yourself from hearing the Word of God and start opening up your heart and say, Lord, here am I. You're going to have to get yourself, you're going to have to start, you know, really believing what we've been singing. Our hearts are open, wide open. Instead of sheltering yourself in whatever it is that you're, people live in their own self-justification, you know. Always an excuse. Always an explanation. There's no explanation for sin. There's no explanation for defiance, for rebellion. There's no explanation for doing it your own way. There's no explanation. There's only an opportunity to repent, to confess your sins, and the Lord Jesus to forgive you and cleanse you. It's just that simple. Hello. Hello. You're very blessed to be here tonight. You're very blessed to be in a place where somebody's going to call you into a place, in a realm called the fear of the Lord that hates evil. It's where wisdom starts. It's where the knowledge of the holy is received and attained and given. The Spirit of the Lord is poured out. The Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, Spirit of counsel and might, Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. That's what's been given to us without measure, an unlimited measure of it. The very life of Jesus. The very life of Jesus, it brings us into a union with the Father, a communion with Almighty God, where we have access by the Spirit into the heavenly realm to come into the holies of holies with all boldness by the blood of Jesus Christ, to live in a communion of oneness with the Father, where we stand in His presence and He lives in us, where He moves us and inspires us with all of His nature and all of His character and all of His splendor and all of His majesty. And there are very few people taking advantage of it because they're constantly distracted with the cares of this life and compromised by the acts of sin. They've never known the strength of the Lord and the power of His might so that they can stand against all the principalities and spiritual wickedness in high places. They've never been in a relationship where they can have the whole armor of God, understand what it means to live in a realm called glory, live in a realm called heaven. Father invites you. You're going to start lifting up your voice. You're going to have to get serious about it. You have to come out from among them. You listen to me. You listen to me. You listen to me. You have to come out from among them. You listen to me. Everything about the world is an act of hostility against God. Everything about it. You need to understand that Father's demanding of you that you begin to define what worldliness is and separate yourself from it. I'm telling you right now, you listen to me. This is a reality in God. You better get right. Jesus is coming. You better purify yourself. He's on His way. Everyone who has this hope purifies himself even as He's pure. Hello. God says for us to be holy just as He is holy. The Lord says we're righteous even as He is righteous. God said we're to walk even as He walks. Let me go through it again. Because I'm going to tell you right now, most people are not listening. In the world today, in the Western world today, they're not hearing God say, be holy as I am holy. Walk as I walk. Be righteous as I'm righteous. Purify yourself even as I'm pure. A declaration, an assignment from Him that says, you are in this world even as I am. Your life and your existence in the world is the same existence that I had. We've known and believed the love that God is for us. God is love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. For as he is, so are we. So are we in this world. Get the word in you. Get the word in you. Halabakanadasiata. Get the word in you. Hallelujah. Get the knowledge of the word in you. God has, we've been born of an incorruptible seed by the word of God. Praise God for that. The word is in me. Christ Jesus, the word is in me. Praise God, the Holy Ghost is in me. The word of God connects me with the reality of that. By the truth of God's word, I connect with the reality of what God has done through me, through the miracle of salvation. Without his word, I become completely, as it were, disconnected from the reality of what God has done. That's why the meeting is important tonight. It's important tomorrow night. I want to be in church tomorrow night. I just can't find hardly anybody to come. Everybody's got their own things they want to do. I'm in church every night.
Amen.
I'm going to be in heaven all my rest of my existence. Father is going to come at the end of the tribulation. He's going to come. He's going to send Christ Jesus, the Word. He's going to come and rule with a rod of iron. He's going to smash everything that gets in the way. That's how he's going to deal with it. Amen. You don't like what I got to say? He's going to smash you. Amen. That's what the Scripture says about Jesus' reign. That he's not coming like a lowly Lamb of Galilee to offer himself as a sacrifice for our sin. Praise God that he did. He's coming with a fire, with eyes as a flame of fire. Huh? His hair, white like wool. Hallelujah. And he looks like he's on fire in the fire. And he slays the wicked with the sword of his mouth, the word of his mouth. He comes from Bozrah in Edom with his garments dipped in blood, smashing the wicked. Stomping the wicked. Amen. Boy, I'm just smashing a humanism tonight, ain't I? God hates sin. God hates iniquity. God is everything opposed to the demonic realm. And you better get opposed. You better be disposed to be opposed. In Jesus' name. And after that, after the reign of 1,000 years, and he's brought all governments down, and all the rebellion is down, destroyed, brought down, and he destroys the at last enemy, death. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 23 through 26. He makes Father accepted to come on in. He prepares the way for the Father to come and inhabit all things. Oh, yeah. And the Father's going to purify the old thing. He's going to create new heaven, new earth. Wherein it's only righteousness. There'll be no more sin, no more iniquity. There'll be no more opportunity for a rebellion again. Hallelujah. Harobokaya shikamonda. I'm going to be right over there jumping up and down shouting. Hallelujah. And then, I mean, you think about that. The New Jerusalem is pictured as coming down out of heaven as an exceedingly high mountain. Huh? Woo! It goes up in the atmosphere about 2,400 miles. Between 2,400 and 3,300 miles straight up in the atmosphere is how tall it is. Woo! It's a high mountain. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. The Himalayas, or the highest peak of the Himalayas, I think, is 29,000 meters. Huh? Huh? 29,000 feet. Yeah, 29,000 feet. Thought 29,000 meters a little bit much. And you know what? That's less than 6 miles, ain't it? Huh? This is going to be 2,400 to 3,300 miles, depending on how you measure, straight up in the atmosphere. That's how high the mountain is. And it's 24 to 33 wide. Hallelujah. Pretty much anywhere you stand in earth, you'd be able to look out on the horizon and see the light and the glory of it. Because it's always going to be shining with the light of his presence. Woo! And the whole place is going to be like the Garden of Eden. You know, I didn't like hardly anything about that new Noah movie. That was just dark. They didn't know what they were doing. It's just some idiot did that. No, I know where they got it from. They got it from Talmudic literature, Kabbalicism. It's a mysticism within the Jewish culture. But you know what I liked about it? But that's classified as what I previously said. I just don't want to go through it again, okay? But you know what I really liked about it? I liked the spring that came up and began to flow out. And where it flowed out, it began to heal the land. Trees started coming up everywhere. They got that part right, kinda. But it's going to be far better than that. Because when Jesus comes, sets up the kingdom at the end of the tribulation, at his second coming, there's a river that is going to flow out of Jerusalem. And it's going to go out. And two major branches are going to go out and going to go then break out into every different branch that will fill the whole earth and heal all the earth. And it's going to spring up like the Garden of Eden. It is. And then Papa's going to say, that ain't going to be good enough. Papa's going to make it all new. He's going to make it all new. He's going to make it all new. He's going to make a new heaven. He's going to put new limits. He's going to put new bounds. Hurrah, bakashi, la montana. Hallelujah. Look, God is eternal. We're on the beginning of it. God is eternal. We're right at the beginning. Hallelujah. There's a lot of exciting. We go on a good place. Okay, we on our way to something like you don't want to miss. I don't care what you got to go through if they hang you up by your ankles and beat you in the shins all day. It's worth it. Yeah. And to hung you up by your ankles and beating you in the shins all day, it's worth it. Yeah. And nobody having to do that. All you got to do is say no to sin and iniquity. Say no to your compromises with the world and your own stubborn attitudes. Yeah. Your own rebellious thoughts. Listen to me. This doesn't go with the flow of the apostasy. This doesn't work in itching ear doctrine. Huh. Somebody said, you a motivational speaker? You bet. I motivate people to get right with God in Jesus' name right now. Get right with God. God is a holy God. And he demands holiness. And holiness is defined by being totally 100% separated from everything that belongs to the world, from everything that is dark and demonic. He's a God of lights in whom is no variableness nor shadow in turning. It's holy, holy, holy. All of his works in holiness. And the seraphims watch him in total ecstasy, completely freaking out over his holiness and his glory. And with two wings, they cover their face. And with two wings, they cover their feet. And with two wings, they do fly. And I'm telling you, it's a wild thing. I thank God that he's allowed me to see it in the spirit, in the vision, to understand them. They do fly, cry, holy. And they go by his throne, holy. Holy. And there's more than three of them. Hallelujah. And heaven is filled with his glory, and it's an exciting and beautiful and fearful and terrible thing. God's coming in his glory, and he's coming in his majesty. He's going to kick hell out the place. And people love hell. They love darkness more than they love light. They love death more than they love life. Because every man knows in their heart of the wickedness that that men are steeped in. And I tell you, there's a purity and a holiness that's far greater than the wickedness that you behold. But yet men want to gravitate to that and live in a world where they don't need Jesus. Try to live in a world where they don't need the Holy Ghost. Try to live in a world where they don't need to be born again. Oh, everything's folklore and legend and fantasy, except for the fantasy you stooped in. Huh? I was talking to an atheist, and he's trying to tell me that what he believes is not a philosophy. I said, you know what? You know, you just don't, you're totally not even connected with reality. Oh, I don't have philosophy. Your philosophy is atheism. Yeah. And then I started telling him where his atheist, he started telling me his ideas. I started telling him the sources, the philosophical sources of his atheism. And he was so stupid, he doesn't even know where his beliefs come from. I mean, at least if you're going to believe something, at least know where your beliefs come from. At least know the guy who first espoused what it is you believe. Because nobody's got the original thought. Hello. Are you listening to me? Everything that you think was put in you by someone else. You have no original thought. Oh, I make my own decision. No, you're a prisoner. You're a prisoner of those who already made decisions for you and you believe them.
Yeah.
Father came and gave to us the words of life.
Amen.
He came to us and gave us the truth so that we might be liberated and set free by the truth. There is no liberty outside the Holy Ghost. And there is no freedom outside the truth. People try to grab a hold of all these ideas, these demonic ideas that they now have in the United States of America, in the Western world, and say it's freedom. Ah, it will be soon discovered that it is tyranny and that it has for its end only the loss of all those things that everybody would hold dear. But you can't have freedom and liberty with sin and iniquity. They're exclusively separate.
Yeah.
They have two 100% divergent pathways. The Lord says this. He says in Proverbs chapter 2, verse 4, if you seek her as silver. Anybody gone silver mining? Silver mining's tough. You don't usually get to pan for silver. You have to do hard rock mining for silver. You got to pick axe for silver. And you come up short again and again and again before you ever possibly find a vein. You have to ask yourself, because I know people go and give their whole life to have a bank account, to have more money, to do this, to do that. Listen, people, you could live more modestly than you're living. You don't need to spend all your life wearing yourself out because your heart is not into the Word. Your heart is into your earthly existence, into the toys that you can have and the stuff you can have. You could eat a lot more simple. You'd be healthier eating salads anyways. Kind of thing. You know what I'm saying to you. Come on, people. I watch people have all these excuses. All these excuses and all these explanations for why they do not pursue God with this kind of earnestness and this kind of desperation. Because I'm telling you right now, God said, these are the conditions. These are the conditions. I don't care whether you open up John, Matthew, Mark, Ephesians. Same conditions. Because when we talk about wisdom in Proverbs, we're talking about the Holy Ghost. When we talk about understanding, we're talking about the Holy Ghost. When we talk about knowledge, we're talking about the Holy Ghost. The Spirit of the Lord, the sevenfold anointing of the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of understanding, the Spirit of might, Spirit of counsel, Spirit of knowledge, Spirit of fear of the Lord. We're talking about the Holy Ghost over here. I'm gonna press you into change. You think I'm gonna stand around here in 2016 and pat you on the back like I did in 2015? There's no way. That's over. We're on the march here. I'm telling you, get rid of this. Get rid of the lethargy. Get rid of the lukewarmness. Get rid of the complacency. Get rid of the apathy. Get rid of the procrastination.
Amen.
And understand the reward of diligence. He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Understand how many times He exhorts us to be diligent, to give all diligence to making our call and election sure. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Praise God.
And you can have it. You can have this being ministered to you and be happy the whole time.
Yeah, amen.
Hallelujah. Let the righteous smite me and be a help to me. I feel better. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Just slap me again. Hear me?
Yeah.
If You seek for her as silver. See, Moses laid his hands on Joshua. And when he did, the Spirit of the Lord came upon Joshua. And the scripture said he received the Spirit of wisdom. The glory of heaven. What are you hungry for? What are you desperate for? What do you need? What do you want? Do you want the insights of heaven? Or you want to go with the changing concepts of men? Because I'm telling you right now, it's on the 20th edition. And it's going to have 20 more in the next 20 years. One edition here. One edition. The unchanging, infallible Word of truth that God watches over to hasten it, to bring it to pass. Yes. Hallelujah. I'm talking to you tonight by the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm running off rebellion and stubbornness, and people want to do it their own way and believe it their own way and argue with the folks around them. Huh? Father's not interested in our ideas. And if he wants our ideas, he'll ask us for them. And if we'll come into a relationship with him the way he wants us to, he won't hide anything from us that he's going to do. He'll reveal it to us. He's brought us into a relationship, if we're willing to participate, where everything he has, he's given it to us. He empowers us. Yes. Satan controls. God empowers. Yes. It's time, people, you change. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
You start smiling more. Dancing more. Rejoicing more,
amen.
Singing more, amen. Praising more,
amen.
Giving thanks more,
amen.
Just cooperating with God the Holy Ghost more, just being happy and living life. Somebody said, I'm making my own choices. Oh, so you choose to be depressed and sad. Oh, weird, really weird. There's medication for that. Not going to do you any good, but nonetheless, that's a lie. Nobody chooses to be depressed and sad. They're under the dictatorship of a demonic force.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jesus Christ comes and says, free. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So we can live the life abundantly. Hallelujah. With the oil of joy, with the oil of gladness, with the peace that passes understanding. Hallelujah. For the Lord, listen to this, then shall you understand the fear of the Lord. No, oh, I didn't finish 4. If you search for her as silver, and you go after her as for hid treasure. Huh?
Yeah.
Silver miners, prospectors, quit their jobs. You can't do silver mining and work another job. You understand me?
Yes.
Treasure hunters are not bivocational. They leave everything to go search for the treasure. Huh?
Yes.
Jesus said, it's like finding a pearl of great price and going and selling all that you have that you may obtain it. It's basically the same as this verse. Finding a treasure hidden in the field, and you go sell all that you have, you may obtain the field. It's just religious to go and sell all you have when you've not seen the pearl. Because you don't want to do it.
Oh, what am I going to do? Well, with my job? Oh. Who's going to feed me? Who's going to clothe me? Who's going to care for me? I know God takes care of the birds, but I'm not a bird.
I'll take good care of you.
Yes, he will.
He wants you to just begin to start trusting him. He wants you to trust him right where you're at right now. He wants you to quit putting other things first. If your job's wearing you out so bad you don't have time to spend time with the Lord every day, and you don't make him first, quit your job because you don't have a right to work one, because it's going to send you to a place of an eternity without God.
Yeah.
But if you can get your job sanctified, if you can get sanctified enough to make God first in your life, then go ahead and stay at your job and get everybody, if you can't get them all saved, at least they've had a witness. Yeah. Huh? And you let them know that, listen, you know, I'm not working overtime around here, hallelujah, in the way that you can, because I got an appointment to keep with the Lord. Yeah. Amen?
Amen.
It's true. You start putting God first, I'm telling you right now, you'll have so much favor, you won't have to anyways. Hmm? You give the devil an inch in your life, where you're not making God first, and he'll be a good taskmaster for you. And everybody around you who are his servants will treat you the same. I hope you can hear me tonight.
Yes.
You're going to have to go after spirit knowledge, the things of the wisdom and knowledge and understanding, the things that God the Holy Ghost is teaching. This Word of God that has been made available to us tells us everything that Father's purpose for us to do, shows us how to step into all the realms of all of His nature and of all of His behavior and of everything that pleases Him, shows us how all of life consists, how it came into being, how it exists right now, and we don't have any time for it. And it's like I was saying the other day. There are whole realms of thinking that you've got to go learn. You've got to go learn quantum mechanics to think with that kind of logic. And there's certain problems that you can only solve if you know how to think with that kind of logic. And I can go through a lot of various different disciplines like that. You can't even begin to think with the logic of God, the understanding of God, until you grab a hold of these things in the Word. And you can't even begin until you're born of the Spirit, because it's too high for men. Men did not have that kind of intellect. You're listening to me?
Yes.
Men don't have this kind of intellect. The Father gives to us a free gift by the Holy Ghost through the blood of Jesus Christ, the ability to move with Him, to know Him, to understand, to agree with Him, to see, hallelujah, to know. Here it is, it unfolded to us. Then shall you understand the fear of the Lord. When you go after these things, like I just described, like God just described, then you shall understand the fear of the Lord. You know what the fear of the Lord will do for you? It will cause you to escape out of every snare of death. You know what the fear of the Lord will do for you? It'll cause you to hate evil. You know what the fear of the Lord will do for you? It'll cause you to hate arrogance and the forward mind, forward thinking, the forward tongue, the forward way. Come, my children, hearken unto me, and I'll teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is he that loves life and wants to see length of days? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips that they speak no guile. Speak nothing evil of anyone ever. Hallelujah. Follow after peace and pursue it. This fear of the Lord. There's things that He holds us responsible for in terms of relationship with one another as well as relationship with Himself. The privilege of being able to walk in the love that only the Holy Ghost can supply to us. A love that will be an access and a doorway into the fullness of everything the Father has, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and by it now be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto Him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can think or ask, according to the power that is working on the inside of you and me right now. You need to learn how to let the wellspring spring, the river flow. Ambreseteas to tell you how to hook up with the Holy Ghost, and the Word of God shows us. For the Lord gives wisdom, and out of His mouth, these are the words of His mouth, and out of His mouth comes understanding. Jesus. Botom brista inglesto kanamayev. Boda stiprini. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I want everybody in this place, I want you to lift your hands towards heaven right now. Just lift your hands towards heaven. In Jesus' name, I set you free. In Jesus' name, I break off the strongholds that bind you. In Jesus' name, I break off the mind-blinding spirits who would try to hide the glory of the gospel from you. Right now, in the name of Jesus, be strengthened by the Spirit in your inner being to be able to walk with God, know God, and do what God calls you to do in the assignments that He's given you. The Lord says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And the knowledge of the holy, or the knowledge of God, is understanding. He says that the fear of the Lord is a fountain of life. And they that have it escape the snares of death. He said unto man, he said, behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. And to depart from evil is understanding. There is a place where God invites us to come in. He says the flesh profits nothing. He says that which is born of the flesh is flesh, but that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Paul takes that and says, takes that up in Romans 8, 9, says, you're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Because we've been born of God. And everyone who is born of God keeps himself in this realm and doesn't sin. And the wicked one cannot touch him. Why? Because you pursued the knowledge of the holy. You pursued this wonderful glory of being under the power and guidance, authority of the Holy Ghost, who's taught us to walk in the ways of life and filled us up with every good thing.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So that we can walk in the knowledge that departs from evil and the understanding that God gives. To have nothing to do with wickedness in our life. He says, and unto man he said, behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. Fear God. I have a fear of God. You know why? I know what He is. I know He's a holy God, demands holiness from me. I know He's a righteous God who demands righteousness from me. I know that He will not justify the wicked. I know that He's made a way of escape and came and given me all power so I could be everything that He wants me to be, and He's going to judge me based upon that life. And I know that He's not going to wink at sin. I know that sin is death. He said to Adam, in the day that you disobey me, you will die. And Adam died, not physically, but spiritually that day. And all men are subject to the same. To this day. He said, don't say that when you're tempted, you're tempted of God. For when a man is tempted, he's drawn away of a strong desire and enticed. And after the sin comes forth death. That's what the Lord says. But the Lord gives us wisdom. So that we can add the fear of the Lord, so that we can always see Him before us and on our right hand, that we should not be moved. So we recognize, wait a minute, to play with sin and to play with iniquity is to play a game of a demonic realm that ultimately has for it the wages of sin, which is death and deception. I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to hear God. I'm not going to run the risk. I cry out to the Lord continually, lead me in the path of righteousness for your namesake. Keep me, O God. I thank you, Lord, that you set me before, that you yoked me before and behind, and you set your hand upon me. People, it's time that we begin to grab a hold of the reality of the judgments of God, because the spirit of humanism and every mind-blinding spirit that works right now in the church today is doing everything it possibly can to effectively remove men from Holy Ghost conviction and understanding of how evil sin is, to ensnare them into a lifestyle of continued iniquity. Behold, the fear of the Lord, that's wisdom. And to depart from evil, that is understanding. I want you to stand with me. I want everybody to listen to me here in this place and by web. You can't depart from evil when you invite it into your house. Hello? You can't bring DVDs and CDs and all kinds of things right out of the world that's got all kinds of lasciviousness in it and all kinds of things that literally unveil the mind of Satan into your house and say that you're departing from evil. You can't invite all of these things that are designed in a worldly system within the framework of the media to just broadcast continually in your sanctuary and say you're departing from evil. Not to even begin to mention the places. I don't believe that there's anybody in here that you go out what they call nightclubbing, partying. I don't believe. But that fits right in very well with Baal worship, and it's just exactly what they did to get drunk and dance around. Yeah. Yeah, actually the Greek word, this is going to shock you, but actually the Greek word that we translate dance within that framework of the worldly dance is actually the word that we derive orgy from. It's pretty hectic. And the church is just all compromised, caught up in that stuff. It's Baal worship. It's just like Baal worship to get drunk and dance around and invite all kinds of demon spirits to ultimately result in sexual immorality. And Satan's even done it on a bigger level now because he's got the World Wide Web. People, you better watch it. You better watch what you're doing with that. If you're not able to depart from evil, huh? Because that's just like going and visiting places right there in your own home. It's like going and visiting places. You better make sure you have protections on that thing. The fear of the Lord calls you to depart from, the fear of the Lord is wisdom, and understanding calls you to depart from evil. Spirit knowledge will help you. Spirit knowledge will show you how to walk in the ways of God. How to yield yourself completely over to the force of heaven, to the power of the Lord and the strength of His might. Hallelujah. But if you have a will, and if you want, if you open up yourself to these things, Satan can come in. He'll snare you. There's some of you just need to know that God, that just as important to God as your attitude, your disposition. A melancholy, depressed disposition has nothing to do with the Holy Ghost. It's a fruit that you don't walk it in the Holy Ghost. You need to learn how to let holy emotions rise up on the inside of it. You need to learn how to worship till holy emotions get there. Holy passions. God said, out of your kolia, out of your belly, out of your kolia, a word which in Attic Greek refers to your passions. God wants to begin to move in your passions. Needs to become an exciting thing on the inside of your life. A worship and a praise and a shout that you just don't have to have somebody, you don't have to have somebody else, you know, shouting and praising, doing your shouting and praising for you so you can kind of join in. You know what I'm saying? Constantly living off the rain from someone else's roof. I'm kind of thing. You know what? Drinking from somebody else's spring. God gave you a spring. Amen. Hallelujah. Change. Take the veil off, look in the mirror, and behold the glory. And change. Get hungry for God. Get 3 chapters a day hungry. Just get 10 minutes a day hungry. And of course, I'm not going to be satisfied with that. 10 minutes a day hungry, my goodness. You're a blip on the spiritual monitor. That's barely above baseline. God wants you to shine bright. Live great for the kingdom. Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. See, that's a miracle. That's a miracle. That ain't you. That is God the Holy Ghost. But you're totally yielding to Him. So now it is you. Why? Because your spirit's hooked up with the Holy Ghost. But that's Holy Ghost. That's pure Holy Ghost. That genuine Holy Ghost. I'm just happy about it. Somebody said, you need to point out what God's doing. I'm going to point it out. I'm very common. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, I got left out. Well, get in a deeper flow so we can ignore, so that we can see something going on. Hallelujah. Get past your human stuff. Get into the spectacular in God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Every one of you, God's ordained you to be signs and wonders and miracle workers. Every one of you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We had a guy come sit in our house, and he wanted me to be CEO of his pharmaceutical company. And he's telling me about these new drugs that he had for dealing with a couple different orphan diseases. And, you know, he's basically talking to Anna and myself. And so, you know what? I'm going to tell you right now, I got a better cure. Yeah. I don't have time to do that. I got a better cure. You got to do all that stuff. I go, Jesus. Hallelujah. I lay my hands on the sick, and they recover. CEO, well, I'm going to give you all kinds of money. I don't care about the all kinds of money. I care about the lost and dying world. Well, I do too, he said. We'll take all this money and we'll use it for the kingdom. That'll be the day. Da, 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 da. I've heard that line over and again. Jesus, help us. I don't want that to be your line.
No.
But I'll tell you right now, if what you're doing, God's not in the big middle of it, and you don't have time enough for the things of the Spirit, then we'll sing that'll be the day about you. Because if God saturates everything you're doing, then yeah, then the results of it will be the kingdom. But you listen to me. You make sure you get everything, you hear me?
Yes.
You better make sure everything's right in the middle of the kingdom. Hallelujah. I was actually a little bit more gentle with him than that. I tell him, I said, you know, man, I can't compromise the gospel. Oh, there's no compromise. And I don't want to get into all what we talked about, but, you know. How much do you sell out for? How much do you sell out for? House, a car, and a boat? What you selling out for? Huh? What do you sell out for? How big is that house anyways? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
How much did Bill Gates sell out for? I don't know if any of you ever knew God, but what should it profit a man that gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Right. I'm going to ask you, you listen to what Jesus Christ said in the call that he gave and demand that he gave for our lives. And you examine yourself. You let God examine yourself. You let God examine you, and you ask God, Lord, am I doing what you called me to do? Is the fruits of the Holy Ghost and a hunger for the things of the kingdom of God and a willingness to be an obedient servant of yours being expressed in my life? And let the Word of God be the light upon your life. And if you're not right with God, get right with God. It's just that simple. You say, oh, but you don't understand, I'm afraid. I've got to make so many changes. I'm going to make the changes slowly. That's just like what the sinner says about coming to salvation. Well, I'm not ready yet. You know, I've got to make some changes and adjustments. You're never going to make any changes and adjustments. You come right now. You come and you bow before the throne. And you call upon the name of the Lord. And He come and save you. He come and deliver you. You do the same thing with the way you're living. I don't make it about how many times people talk to other people about Jesus, but I'm going to tell you right now, when the fire of God is in your life, the glory of heaven is in your life, you're going to be telling them about Jesus. You listen to me. When God the Holy Ghost has a hold of your life, you're not going to shut up. Amen. And nobody can shut you up.
Amen.
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 And you feel free to walk around wherever you are. Just being who you are. They say, what is that language there? Oh, that's heavenly language. Well, what do you mean? Yeah, well, that's tongues of the Holy Ghost, tongues of fire. Would you like to have it? Everything becomes very natural. Very natural. You with me?
Yes.
You go into grocery store and person, most people, they got you got a word of knowledge already because they got the little name tag on it. And you see, Paul, my goodness, you're marked for the kingdom of God. Do you know who Paul is? And they're like standing there shocked while you're just downloading. Paul was saw this guy who met Jesus on the road to Damascus. You know, Jesus who was crucified and rose on the third day. He came and appeared to Paul. I mean, you just do it. It's just so natural. You don't need all this other stuff, all this canned stuff. You just be who we are. Hallelujah. Citizens of the kingdom of God. Belonging to a new race. Hallelujah. Woo. Parase do rimande. Hallelujah. Man, just follow Geneva around a couple of days. Hallelujah. Find out how to talk to people about the things of God. You know, my mother's just so full of the Holy Ghost, she never met a stranger. We want that to be in your life. Just never met a stranger. Allie's that way too. She never met a stranger. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. Look, don't let this night be in vain. I went through too much to deliver this word. For it just, I mean, I had to go through a lot. Don't let this be in vain. Don't let these things be in vain in your life. In Jesus' name. Clean the house. It's Passover. Get the leaven out. You want heaven? Get rid of the leaven. Get it out. God, the Holy Ghost will give you insight and wisdom. Shut stuff off. Start listening to what's going on inside. Hallelujah, because God, the Holy Ghost is inside. Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We want you to be healed if there's sickness in your body. We want you to be strengthened by the Holy Ghost if there's weakness in your body. We want you to be strengthened in your inner man so you can stand up against everything that try to pull you out of happy land. They would try to distract you. Jesus. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes. Katarashaya. Father, thank you for this Holy Ghost anointing. Thank you for this Holy Ghost anointing. Thank you, Father, for this Holy Ghost anointing. If there's anybody here tonight, you've never given your life over to Christ Jesus. You've never, and you know, maybe you don't even know what that means. It means this: if you call upon the name of the Lord, you become an entirely different person, a person that is acceptable to God. Until the miracle of salvation happens, you are not acceptable to God. Well, I'm beating humanism up bad tonight. Everything I'm saying, I'm just like, and we're hitting it hard. Praise God. Break that thing off of you. I guess there must be somebody watching by the web. I'm going to say it again. You are not acceptable to God. There's people who say, well, then if that's the way it is, so be it. Well, that's stupid. Because with that response, you're going to spend an eternity in a place called the lake of fire. And the first second that you're there, you're going to want to be completely delivered. But there is no repeal.
That's right.
There's no getting out. It's prison for eternity. For rejecting God. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, I break the mind-blinding spirits. I destroy the power of Satan right now that would cause you to think so that way. So that now you have sanity to be able to make a right choice. And it's a beautiful thing that God has given to us if we'll step up into the authority and the power of it. He's given us power to open up the eyes of the blind, to turn them from Satan to God, from the power of darkness to light. Hallelujah. Otherwise, people are going to have that response. You are not acceptable to God the way you are. But you know what? There are going to be maybe 1 in 100. That are going to be broken, and they're going to go, I want to be acceptable to God. I'm not acceptable to God the way I am. They're not going to be stubborn. They're not going to be rebellious. It may be 1 in 100, but I want the other 99. I'm going to go after the other 99. I want to press in. Would you press in with me for such a great Holy Ghost trembling fear in this house?
Yes.
Right here.
Yes.
And I'm going to tell you how to do it. It begins with your own life. It begins with your own life. That there's a Holy Ghost fear and a Holy Ghost conviction and trembling before the Lord. And it sounds like a paradox that you could be doing that and be exceedingly glad. But it's not a paradox. You really can be. We the tremblers. The Lord said, I look to this man. He said, heaven is my throne. The earth is my footstool. You're going to build a house for me to stay in? The heavens of heaven can't contain me. But to this man will I look. Or to this woman will I look. He that's broken and contrite and trembles at my word. I'm going to tremble. Start trembling.
Yeah.
If you're not trembling, you need to get to trembling.
Yeah.
You're not trembling because you're just still in darkness. Got mind blinders on. I break them off you now. I break it off you now. I break it off you now. In Jesus' name. You know what we do? When a pack of coyotes out there right by the door and are yapping so loud you can't sleep, we go outside with a door with a gun and we pop one off.
Yeah.
And they gone. We're going back to bed. Hallelujah. That's what we're doing right now.
Yeah, amen.
This is why you got to get so loud. Sometimes we got to get loud.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Run that mess off. Cut tarabashaya. Hallelujah. People, we love you. We're going to be gentle with you. We're going to do everything we can do not to get up in your face and tell you how bad off you are and how much you need to change. You listen to me. We love you. But I'm going to tell you right now, we're going to listen. We're going to get up in your face and tell you how God has so radically changed you and made a way for you to walk with him, so to quit acting like you've been acting. Made a way for you to be able to fully express who he is in your life. Now get yourself out of your protective zone. People, they're all protective. Oh, you know, he's going to say something that's going to offend me. I know he's talking bad about me. Get out of that. Get out of that. It's demonic.
Yeah.
It's a demonic realm.
Yeah.
It's a harassing demonic realm that runs interference with the word of God.
True.
Seeds go forth. Little brother, I'm so blessed with you. It is true.
Yeah.
I tell you right now, I am just so blessed with you. Hallelujah. Yeah. Youngest one in the house, man. He's on it, though. I'm telling you.
Yes,
right now.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I don't want to let you go till you repent. I mean, I just don't want to let you go. I don't want to let you go tonight until you get right with God. I don't want to let you go tonight until you absolutely can. Completely give yourself over to what God the Holy Ghost wants to do with your life. Some of you are going to go compromise tomorrow. Because I can feel it. Some of you, because you created a pattern for your life, you're going to go and you're going to act like the world tomorrow. Some of you in school. Some of you in your workplace. You're going to go and be assimilated. And it needs to be cut off tonight. Because all you're doing is sowing to the flesh and you're going to reap a whirlwind of destruction there. It's time to start sowing to the Holy Ghost. God in His love has made a way for a miracle change, the great miracle change to come into our life. And there's a continual miracle change. Grab hold of it. Go after it like silver. Listen to me. Go after it like hid treasure. Quit playing games with God. Come on now. Maybe some of you need to change your environment. Maybe you just... There's just no way out for you. You just don't have the capacity. You don't know God enough. You're not willing to do what God says that you have to do if you're going to be strong to stand against it. God tells us very clear things that we have to do if we're going to have His strength to be able to deal with the powers of darkness that are going to come at us. Maybe some of you just are not willing to do it. You will not make room for God. You know I'll not make room to apply yourself to these things. And so you're just going to have to change your environment. You're going to have to deal with it. I want you to deal seriously with these things. People, we're living in a serious time. We're living in a more serious time than we've ever lived. We're living in a more crucial, critical time than we've ever lived in. This, I know the Father is going to preserve the United States of America that our voice may be heard throughout the nations, preaching the gospel as we were ordained to do. That's why my ancestors came here in 1620. Listen to me. I know there's been a lot of evil men do a lot of evil things. Doesn't matter. Still, the church still is the biggest thing going, and the reason God bless this nation. And I know what's going to happen. I know that this nation is going to be humbled. I know there's going to be great disaster. I know that. The church is going to be just fine. I mean, I'm talking about the glorious church. I'm talking about the people of God. I'm talking about the people who dwell in the secret place of the Almighty. Amen. Who abide under the shadow of His wing. Hallelujah. They don't drown. They don't burn. I mean, they prosper when everybody else is cursed and, you know. This is a critical time. It's time to seek the Lord. No. It's time to seek Him. There's some changes that got to be made in your life. I'm pleading with you. God, the Holy Ghost is pleading with you. Those of you watching me at home by the web, God's pleading with you. You're not to forsake the assembling of the saints together. You not even have the right to be at home watching this on the web. Repent. Repent. Get right with God. Quit putting yourself first. And serving God at your own convenience. Start laying your life down for the church and for the brethren. Let everybody else do your work. Pray your prayers. Sing your songs. Give you thanks. Give me a break. Get yourself in the building. There are so many people serving God on their own terms. They're not, you listen to me, they're not making heaven. You're not making heaven. You can say, oh, that's what you believe. You know what? It is exactly what I believe. And it's the result of having given myself to knowing the will of the Father. Yeah. As it's written in His Word. So why don't you do the same? Yeah. If you give yourself to the study of the Word, you're going to be changed just by doing it. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Trying to prove me wrong, you'll get right. Amen. Amen. all across this room today, I look at all the people that they come on Sunday morning. I don't even know why they come on Sunday morning. I don't even know why they come. Because they're trying to serve God based on their own terms. Why do they even come here? Why don't you go to a Baptist church? Why don't you tell some of them to go to a Baptist church? Come in here, try to enjoy the anointing for a few minutes, then just walk out just as rebellious as they came in, just as stubborn as they came in. People, don't play games with God. Stop playing games with God.
Amen.
You need to get serious. You need to get real. People need to stand up. Somebody said, oh, well, you know, a preacher friend of mine said, oh, you know, I just got to walk on eggshells because, you know, if I say too much, it's going to be a war. I said, so you're going to let them continue on in their ways. It's going to get worse. They're going to die and go to hell because you don't want to have a war. I said, why don't you go ahead and create a war? Why don't you love them enough to create a war? To tell them that they're wrong and they've got to repent and they've got to get right.
Amen.
You're going to tell me that you're so concerned about their affection for you, you're going to let them continue in their way and die and go to hell. People, that's wrong thinking. When people don't have a hunger for God and they just want to come on Sunday morning, don't come back to church on Sunday morning. I mean, there's a couple of people that I know love God, passionate about God, and they've got some things that are keeping them from being able to come on Sunday night. There's an exception. But there's other people, you're just sitting home, serving yourself. You're not making heaven. You're not right with God. And I doubt you're even watching this on the web right now. Because I don't really even see the Spirit of the Lord there. Time we start letting God, the Holy Ghost, examine us and have His way in our lives and quit playing pretend.
Amen.
No more posing. No more pretend.
Amen.
No more living your own life saying you're the servant of the Lord.
That's right.
No more.
That's right. Thank you, Jesus.
You get the fear of God, I guarantee you're going to find time to pray.
Amen.
You get the fear of God, I guarantee you're going to find time to seek God. I'm going to tell you right now, you get the fear of God and what your appointment with heaven is going to be more important to you than your appointment with any man. Where you're standing with God is going to be more important than you're standing with men. Your life is going to be more important than the things that you put on your body for clothes and the food that you put in your body for nourishment.
Thank you, Lord.
Just break off that yoke tonight. I want that yoke broken. I want that yoke broken. I want that yoke broken. Nothing breaks the yoke like repentance. Nothing breaks the yoke like repentance. Jesus. Tonight, we're just calling everybody to come and fall down at the mercy seat. We're calling everyone tonight, come bind the sacrifice of the horns of the altar. Come live as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Give yourself over to live out the life that Christ Jesus purchased for you at Calvary. That He brought to pass when He was raised up from the dead. Come live out the miracle life of living in the Holy Ghost. Quit living another kind of a life. There needs to be no great disparity. Listen to me. There needs to be no great disparity in the experience of God's people's lives. There needs to be no difference between Reinhard Bonnke and you or whoever else is doing great things in the kingdom of God. The disparity. You know, we were talking today One of Daniel's friends just got out of law school, you know, and he works for a prestigious firm, started about $175,000 a year, and in the next 5 years he'll be making $500,000 a year. And he's just talking about the disparity between all the various different people just in the law community, based upon, you know, a few variables. And it goes in so many different areas of life. And there's, and yet, and we see the same thing, it's almost superimposed upon the people in the church. There needs to be no disparity. God's brought us into oneness with Him to walk out this glory life in Him. Quit compromising, quit chasing other things at the expense of this divine glory and power of God's life being lived through you. In Jesus' name. I guess I don't get to beg no more, plead with you no more. Because I'm feeling like that I'm supposed to stop now. Don't let this be in vain, please. If we went back 70 years ago and looked at the Pentecostal movement, we could just go back 70 years ago and look at the Pentecostal movement, you would see how different it is from what goes on today. But because people live in relativism, you know, they don't even understand. When I say stuff like, the Pentecostal church moved the Holy Ghost to the back room and now you can't even find them there. People go, what are you talking about? Because their definition of what it means to have the Holy Ghost in the meeting is completely different than Pentecost of 1920. Or 1906, or 1930, or 1950. It's time to have mature people in the spirit again. It ain't going to happen until you find a place to go pray. It ain't going to happen until you find a place to go give yourself to the things of the Spirit of God. It ain't going to happen. It ain't going to happen. What does she need? This is the only reaction I'm getting. I'm looking for any reaction. I'm getting some reaction. What does she need? She needs a bottle. Well, praise God, somebody needs something. Somebody's crying out of desperation. I need me a bottle. I need me some food. I need me some food. And you can see how starving she is. God demands it. He commands it. Knowing the severity of God, we thus persuade men. For Christ died for all.
Mama.
You're fine.
Mama.
Listen to me. Then all are dead. That we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves. But unto Him who died for us and rose again.
Mama,
do you hear me?
Mama, mama.
You're okay.
Mama.
She knows what she wants. Maybe she doesn't know what she wants. She wants the baba? Okay. Bless you, baby. I know you need that baba. Rav Sakishti. Great authority in the faith. I'm so blessed. So blessed with my daughter-in-laws, my son-in-law, really my daughters, and my son. I have 3 sons, 4 daughters. Because I can walk up to them, I can say, get right. Don't do this or don't do that. And they listen, just do it. Because I'm not doing it based upon what I want, my preferences. I'm saying, look, we the Holy Ghost people of God. This is my house. And I'm going to make sure that you step into all the good things that God has for you. There's a lot of people that won't listen like that. They're just going to get offended because they're not part of the family. I'm just so glad that you're part of the family. People are part of the family, they don't get offended. Hallelujah. Not when you submitted to the things of the Spirit. Jesus. We don't want anybody leaving out of here tonight sick in your body. We don't want anybody leaving out of here tonight sick in your spirit. We don't want anybody leaving out of here tonight with plans to go and sin tomorrow. Plans to go and return to the same kind of life that you've been living. Father, we thank you for your mercy. Father, we thank you for your amazing love. Holy Ghost, we thank you for your comfort and for your assurance that you give to us that this life that you've commanded us to live, we can live it. That we don't have to live in doubt and unbelief and uncertainty. We don't have to live in a place or a state of being overwhelmed or perplexed. We know that we can step out in you and begin to listen to you and begin to seek you, and that you're going to take us and you're going to yoke us in front and from behind and lay your hands upon us. Hallelujah. How great are your thoughts towards me? How great are the number of them? Hallelujah. Jesus. Anybody? Anybody here tonight? You've never received the miracle of salvation. Your life has not been transformed by the power of God. And you want this life that only you can, that can only be given to you in Christ Jesus. I'm telling you, right where you're standing, whether you're listening to me by the web or by the YouTube, no matter where you're at right now, you call upon the name of Jesus. That name is the most powerful name that exists. By that name, the miracle of salvation will take place in your life. Yes. Jesus. Who's got pain in your body right now? Anybody got pain in your body, up in your thigh? Come right now. Lord's going to heal you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Tokarashi ni kia katani. Hallelujah. Proshakananeyata. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Proshakai. Hallelujah. Where's the pain? Huh?
It's right here. And
yeah.
During service.
All right. Right out of you. Right out of you. Right out of you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Astorine. Astoronasta. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What's up, baby? Where's the pain? Jesus. Thank you, Father, for the anointing. Pain goes right out of you, baby. Right now. It's right out of you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Out! Where's the pain? What's wrong with your shoulder?
I've been having this pain for a while.
I command the pain to go now in Jesus' name. I command the pain to go right now in Jesus' name. It goes out of your shoulder right now. How's that feel? Huh? Huh? How does that feel?
Good. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Well, things are getting good around here now. Where's pain? How's it doing now? In the name of Jesus, I command the pain to go out. How's it doing now?
I don't
No, 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 you don't have to beat on it.
It feels good.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I command you to be healed from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet.
Thank you.
Pain go. Pain go in Jesus' name. Pain go in Jesus' name. Go out of your body now in Jesus' name. Where's pain? What's up? In the name of, huh? The more you stand. In the name of Jesus, pain goes out of your body right now. Look at me. In Jesus' name. In the name of the Most High God, I command the pain go out of your body.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Just stand there. Just stand there. And I do nothing. Jeez. Be healed. Maha to say it.
Thank you.
What's up? What's wrong? What's wrong with your shoulder?
I got a little pain in my shoulder.
In Jesus' name. In the name of the Most High God. Changed now in Jesus' name. Changed right now in Jesus' name. From the inside out. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Changed right now. Stitch your hands towards heaven. Now in the name of Jesus, do not resist me. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in the name of the Most High God. Be strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord in you, amen. Yes, it pronounced tonight. Mr. Priest. Extusina. Touch right now. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Touched. Touched. What's up? Your foot hurts when you run and jump? Your shin? Shin, be strong. Shin. Shin. Have shin in. Be strong. Father, we just thank you so much for your mercy. Father, we thank you for your abundance of mercy. Father, we thank you that you've pled with us, you've dealt with us, you've been long-suffering, grabbing a hold of our lives day in, day out to bring us to a place of submitting to your way, to walk with you, to not live compromised lives, to not live a life integrated into the things of this world. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that your faithfulness is there continually. Your mercy is there continually. Father, we pray now in the name of Jesus that everybody in this place will respond to you, Holy Spirit, so you can show them how to overthrow every power of sin, every power of darkness, every power that would somehow stop the flow of heaven through their lives. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus, every person in this place becomes so filled with your compassions, so filled with your love, so filled with your mercy, so filled with your glory, that it's impossible for them to walk by a person without showing that love, showing that mercy, showing that grace. Father, I pray that every person in this place be so hooked up with what's going on in your heart that they'll begin to cry out for a lost and dying world the way you cry out, the way that you intercede, that our hearts be knitted together with you, Father God, and your righteous cause to do the things that you commissioned us to do. In Jesus' name. I just want everybody to come up here. Just come stand up here. You just must understand, dear people, there's just times. There's just times where we was moving God, the Holy Ghost, with just an urgency. An urgency to have our lives consecrated to Him and submitted to Him, to where there's no part of our lives that are left out in this communion relationship with the Father. Jesus. Take hold of our lives, Lord Jesus. Take hold of our lives, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, we yield ourselves to you. Let there be no stubbornness. Let there be no rebellion. Let there be no defiance. Let there be no resistance in our lives, oh God. May every part of our lives be yielded to you, Lord. Let every part of our lives be yielded to you, Lord. Search me, oh God. Try me, Lord. Know my thoughts. See if there be any wicked way in me. Lead me in your way everlasting. I'm yours, Lord.
I belong to you.
You're in me.
I'm in you.
That's all that I desire.
It's
all that you have.
I'm yours, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. 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 Now you be strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord right now. To live the life that God has called us to live. Because it's not by mind and it's not by power. It's not by anything that we can do of ourselves, but it's by the Spirit of the Lord. And because we're so earnest, because we're so desperate, because this is what we want, we cry out, we lift up our voice, we go after Him. That's just a response that He's looking for to come fill every dimension of our life, rule every dimension of our life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hurababaseya. Hurabababaseya. Hurabababaseya. Hurabababakiarabasatari. Hurabababakasharababayaramashapaya. Ukayara sabra kaina musikina. Ari mamanda rinandolo sorro mamborsia. Miarrare, vesciarre, vendarro, mancato, sciala la mamana. Urra babasserri, mamandandele le chisarra babarada. Surrabai, 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 mendana. Surrabai, musikai. Some of earth. Holy yours, oh God. Holy yours. Oh God. Father, we thank you for your protection, for your keeping power. Holy Spirit, we so surrender our lives over to you, Lord. We only know that it's by you and through you that we can live this life. We thank you that you keep us. We thank you, Father, that every person in this place, you make them sensitive to you. Yes. To be guided by you, directed by you, kept by you. I want you to hear one more time. I want you to hear one more time. You will not be able to do it your way and make heaven. You will not. You will not make heaven doing it your way. You will not. You get into the midst of what God said and you submit yourself to God and to the things that he has very clearly described. Otherwise, you're not making heaven. Don't be deceived. God will not be mocked. Don't let any man deceive you. He that does these things shall not inherit eternal life. And the list goes on. People always waiting. Someday, tomorrow, I'm going to get right later. Leaving it all to the future. While they make a decision to sin. No, that decision to sin, that decision to rebel, that decision to walk in unforgiveness, that decision to walk in a spirit of offense, that decision to walk in those different things that we can name here tonight, is a decision to go that much further away from relationship with the Father. To be that much more entrenched in the power of hell, the sway of the devil. You stand up against sin and you say no. That is your first step towards heaven. That is your first step towards allowing the Holy Ghost to become the one who rules your life and Christ Jesus that rules your life. And it's your first step of yieldedness. Real true yieldedness. Real true yieldedness. Some of your first steps towards maturity. To go on to know the Lord. There's nothing about your life that is hidden. Nothing. Father loves you so much. Father loves you so much. Just like you are. He's not going to accept you like you are. He's going to give you the means by which to change. He loves you so much. He sent his only begotten son. He loves you so much. This meeting just continues to go on for you tonight. And I know it's hard. And some of it's harsh. And some of it's just so challenging. It's just hard to deal with. But the reality of it is deception can so entrench people that there's nothing else that even can reach them. They just sit there with, as it were, earmuffs over their ears. Nothing penetrates. God pleads with you, begs you, petitions you to change. That means you fall, when you fall down, broken before his presence and say, okay, Lord, whatever you want of me, I'll do it. And then you begin to open up the Bible and you begin to read. And all of a sudden your heart gets united and you get in the meetings and you get in church and you get in the flow of the Holy Ghost, every opportunity that you can get into the flow of the Holy Ghost, and there the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the Lord is able to penetrate the hardness that you've been allowing to develop in your life. Tonight in Jesus' name. We grab a hold of thoughts and ideas and things that we've normalized, that we've made okay. And the reality of it is it keeps us from that which Father has for our lives. And the only power that can break that yoke is the Word of Truth and the Spirit of Truth. And if all the Word of God is you really, all the real Word of God you get is a few minutes, a few hours on Sundays or whatever, it isn't going to do. It isn't going to work. When you're born again, when you're changed by the power of God, the first thing that you want is to be in the company of the saints. It's the first evidence of salvation. The second thing is you want to be taught by God. You get a hunger for the Word. It's the second thing. It's just right there. It's almost like it's right there with it. It's almost, can't put it as second, but it's just right there. Third thing, not only do you have a hunger for Word, but you have a hunger for communion with God. So that's prayer. It's just a conversation with the Lord. If these things are not in your life, you're not right with God. You're not saved. You're not born again, or you've backslidden, and you're just as good as not being saved. It's a lukewarm condition. It's a lukewarm spiritual condition of the heart that Jesus Christ made very clearly, I will spew you out of your mouth, my mouth. People have listened to the lies and believed that God is going to accept them as they are. He's not. He is not. That they can do it, they can have it their own way, and that they're going to be acceptable to God. It's no way. I am not going to have things my way and be acceptable to God. I'm not. Doesn't matter how long I preach, how long I've stayed in church, anything I've done, whatever it is I've done. I better be bowing to His Word, submitted to what it is He said, doing it His way, if I'm going to be right with God. He leaves every man to the choice. You know, I've talked to the Lord about this. I mean, I'm telling you right now, I just want to run and tackle people and just knock them down to the floor and say, what's your problem? Because I don't want to see people go to hell. I don't want to see people go on in their defiance against God, saying that they're right, especially when they're saying that they're right. You know what I'm saying? I won't allow it in my house. I won't allow it in my house. And it's not like I'm kicking anybody out. I'm going to be on who's ever in my house till they get it right. Yes. We're not having it this way. We're correcting it. It's not going to be like that. Amen. Here's what we're going to do it God's way. Yes. See, when people just have a simple willingness to say, I want to do it God's way, then it isn't about my way versus their way. No, you just tell me what. No, I'm declaring to you God's way. Here, go read it for yourself. So when it's in the heart of anyone to do things God's way, then they hear someone like me describing God's way, and they don't stand there unwilling to change with this lifeless, emotionless, expressionless look on their face. It's actually a sense of it's actually kind of like being in a coma, spiritual coma. Being so anesthetized with offense and unforgiveness that you cannot sense the stimuli of life. Pretty radical, isn't it? Come on, people. The church has got to be the salt of the earth. We've got to be the light of the world. We've got to quit. Trying to do it our own way and press into what Father has commanded us to simply do. And if we'll do it His way, we'll have His results. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. He loves you. He loves you, but that doesn't mean you're going to heaven. God loves you, but don't mean you're going to go to heaven. God loves you doesn't mean you're right with God. In His love, He pursues us to a place of change. To conform to His will, His way. It's not hard to drive to the church. It's an effect of your will. Somebody said, I don't have gas. It's your first breakthrough to greater faith. And I'm serious. It's true. It's your first breakthrough. It's your first breakthrough to greater faith. Somebody said, I don't think people want me. It's a demonic lie. You're under the power of a demonic spirit. It's a stronghold of a demonic power that wants to destroy your soul in hell. Just like the same thing of a demonic power of over a heroin addict or over an alcoholic or over someone who is an abuser of men or someone who is has some kind of other immorality. It's a demonic stronghold. Break the thing off because it's a stinking lie. And it finds its stronghold through unforgiveness and hurt and offense. Because it didn't matter if everybody in the church hated you. God's called you to the church. Of course, you don't want to go to a church. Everybody hates you. So you go find a church where everybody doesn't hate you. Just half the people. Or whatever. Because there's no means by which we then ultimately have an excuse to self-justify why we don't obey God. And everybody loves you here anyways. May not like your behavior, but if you just get in close, we'll get that fixed quickly. But then you're going to have to humble yourself, aren't you? But that's good, because God's not going to have nothing to do with you until you humble yourself. Because he says he's not going to do anything until you humble yourself. You have to get broken and contrite. So it's good to go through the humbling process. You mean I got to humble myself and do what I'm told? Yes. Sorry that your parents didn't help you in that dimension. But you got to humble yourself to do what you're told. But here's the good news. You're not going to have to humble yourself to do what some man's telling you. You're going to humble yourself and do what God's telling you to do. God's going to tell you to walk in love. He's going to tell you to, he's going to tell you to do some basic things. That's just good for you and everybody around you. Amen. You're not going to have much of a relationship in a marriage unless you love each other. That you're good to each other and kind to each other and sensitive to each other. Amen. Ain't going to work out. Hallelujah. Neither is it going to work out in any other dimension. And be on your own. People, don't do that. Don't do that. Get in close. Get in close. Get in close. Just get in close right now. Just get in close right now. Just get in close. Because that's the body of Christ. It's just the body of Christ. The body of Christ, being in close. It's the body of Christ. I mean, that's what I see. I see the body of Christ. And Father wants it to multiply. He doesn't want it to stay as it is. It's a force of your will. I know what Father wants, and the only reason we don't have what Father wants is because we don't agree with Him. There's places where we don't agree with Him simply by not doing it. So start doing it. Start doing what God said. Jesus' name. Yes. We love you. Hug each other. Tell each other you love each other. Do what God says. Do what God says. Do it. Do what God says. Do what God says.